Joe in AP Psych class, and welcome back for another Flex Time Review. In today's lesson, we are going to be talking about factors that lead to group conflict by taking a look at the classic social trap example, the prisoner's dilemma. If you would like to follow along with this video, there is a link in the description box that will bring you to a worksheet that goes along with the lesson. So let's get started. Now, before we get into the prisoner's dilemma, it is important that we get some background information on what exactly a social trap is. A social trap is just going to be any situation in which two or more conflicting parties, by each rationally pursuing their own self-interest, become caught up in mutually destructive behavior. Now, I'm sure we all remember the beginning of the COVID pandemic where toilet paper was more valuable of a commodity than gold. An individual making the rational decision of stocking up on toilet paper and preparing to quarantine is a smart move. But when every single person goes out and decides to do this, it leads to a shortage of the toilet paper. Now, we are going to further explain the social trap as we go through the prisoner's dilemma. But first, a fun little history lesson. The prisoner's dilemma is going to be a standard example of game theory, showing us why two completely rational individuals might not cooperate. Now, game theory is going to be a mathematical model of strategic interaction between rational decision makers. So if this is a mathematical model, why exactly are we talking about it during the social psychology unit? While it is centered around mathematics, its uses are very practical in several social science fields, including psychology. In the 1950s, two very prominent mathematicians, Merrill M. Flood and Melvin Drescher, started to apply game theory to the prisoner's dilemma. All the while, another notable mathematician, John Nash, who you may know as the individual with schizophrenia from the excellent film A Beautiful Mind, was furthering game theory research with his Nash's equilibrium. Today, psychologists are going to use the ideas behind game theory to explain why social traps occur. And we are going to do just that as we finally get into the prisoner's dilemma. Imagine this scenario. Two members of a criminal gang are arrested and imprisoned. Each prisoner is in solitary confinement with no means of communicating with the other. The prosecutors lack sufficient evidence to convict the pair on the principal charge, but they have enough to convict both on a lesser charge. Simultaneously, the prosecutors offer each prisoner a bargain. Each prisoner is given the opportunity to either betray the other by testifying that the other committed the crime, or to cooperate with the other by remaining silent. So in our scenario, we have two main characters. Criminal 1, who we will call Michael, and Criminal 2, who we will call Dwight. Both Michael and Dwight have two choices, leaving us with the social trap game matrix you see before you. So let's go ahead and fill in the rest of our matrix. If Michael and Dwight both cooperate with one another and remain silent, they will be given the lesser charge and both only have to serve 1 year in jail. If one chooses to cooperate and stay silent while the other defects and betrays, the one who stayed silent would serve 3 years in jail, while the one who defected would be a free man. Now, if both Michael and Dwight decided to defect and betray one another, they would both have to serve 2 years in jail. So let's analyze this matrix real quick. At first glance, it makes the most sense for both Dwight and Michael to stay silent and cooperate with one another to benefit the group as a whole, only serving 2 total years, while the other options involve more years served. While this might be considered the most optimal outcome, we are going to see with human nature, it is not going to be the most probable one. Let's take a look at this dilemma from Michael's perspective. Michael has no idea how Dwight is going to respond to the prosecutors, and is also out to serve his own self-interest. As a result, Michael will decide that his best move is to defect and betray Dwight. The reason for this decision? Betraying a partner actually offers greater reward than would be gained if cooperating with them. If Michael defects, there is a maximum prison sentence of 2 years with a minimum of 0 years. While if he cooperates and stays silent, there is a minimum of 1 year served and a maximum of 3. So it's in his best interest to choose to defect. However, Dwight has the same offer under the exact same conditions. And as a result, he will also serve his own interest and defect as well, leading to both Dwight and Michael serving a 2 year prison sentence. There we see our social trap as Michael and Dwight both choose to pursue their own immediate best interest, ending up with longer prison sentences. Now let's attempt to explain why these social traps occur using various psychological explanations. A big one being that social traps work through the use of sliding reinforcers, which is a type of reinforcement that reinforces behaviors in small doses and punishes them in large doses. I want you to imagine you are living in a city during an extremely hot summer day. You decide you're gonna blast your AC in order to cool off, thinking nothing of it. Only how it will cool you down. Well, unfortunately for the city electric grid, you were not the only one with this thought. As everyone cranks their AC up, we see a citywide power outage. This is going to represent the idea of sliding reinforcers, explaining how we get ourselves into social traps. As each individual blasts their AC, they are reinforced with cool air, but as this behavior spreads to more and more people, the power grid fails, resulting in punishment. So obviously, social traps do not lead to positive outcomes for the group as a whole. It's kind of in its name. social trap. Not going to be a good thing. So how exactly are we going to attempt to overcome them for the betterment of society? Modern psychologists believe the best way to do this is to increase cooperation. With better communication, agreed upon regulations, and through promoting the awareness of our responsibility toward bettering our communities, nation, and humanity as a whole. And on top of the prisoner's dilemma helping us explain the social psychology concept of social traps, its core premise was also turned into an excellent game show known as Friend or Foe that aired in 2002 and basically had two people decide whether they were going to share winnings with each other or attempt to steal all of the gains for themselves. As you can imagine, this led to some pretty funny moments on TV.
Do you think you're trustworthy, Phil?
I think I'm trustworthy, yeah.
Summer, how was it for you?
Good. I hope. That's what I felt.
$7,200 is up for grabs. Let's find out. Phil, if you're a friend or a foe. Oh, Phil, you went foe. That means either you're walking out of here with $7,200 or you're getting nothing. Depends on whether or not Summer really is as sweet as she seems. Summer, let's see if you're a friend or a foe. Yes, you want friends, Summer.
$200.
Dang, Phil. Brutal. I mean, heck, if only Summer would have taken AP Psych in high school, then maybe, just maybe, she would have been more prepared for this situation in her life. So anyways, that does it for our lesson on social traps and the prisoner's dilemma. If you enjoyed, please do feel free to like and subscribe. It is always appreciated, and it will keep you posted for when I post new videos. Until next time.